Okay, I will call this working meeting order on Wednesday, April 5th, 2017. We got a few minutes for, yeah, thanks, Ann.
You're welcome.
To, but Dana, I don't think there'd be any else coming for, with you, is there, Dana?
No.
Okay. When you're.
Since we have a couple minutes by my clock, 7, do you want to do our budget first? Since we're leaders, it kind of makes sense to me that we would have ours completed before asking anyone else to.
Well, yes, we can then. We have to wait till Debbie gets here, everyone.
No, it says the commission budget, that means commissioners. We all have the paperwork. Mike, we do this every year, the three commissioners go through our budget and determine what we want to budget on the given line items. And I think it would be helpful, since this is your first time, to for sure do ours so that we understand what these guys have done before coming to see us or are coming to see us in prepping to begin to do. On the sheet is the one with the, yeah, that's the one.
Not this one. This is the one that Scott Dunning has left.
Is this the one that Scott left? This is the one that Scott left?
Yeah.
No. Debbie emailed us the forms maybe 3-4 weeks ago, and we just haven't done it yet. We were going to do it last Thursday after the County Compensation Board meeting. So what it says at the top, it says Broadwater County Expenditure Budget Report, multi-year actuals. So what we do... These are the actual spendings that we did for the past 4 years.
Okay.
And here's the columns for that. This was the current budget, but this is the actual spending.
Okay.
So this is what we use. This is where we will input what we expect to spend. A budget is not solid. It's a living document. It will change as the year goes on. And that's why the law allows us to do budget amendments like last week. These are budget changes, so for us, we probably won't have much in the budget changes, but if somebody, Susie Johnson, our department head from the circus, came in and said that she wanted to increase her operating supplies by $10,000. She'd put $10,000 over here. We'd go through and say, that's quite a jump. We're going to take it back to two. So that's what this column is for. When Debbie gets from us our authorization for either the department head's numbers or our alternative numbers, she'll plug them in here, and that'll be the final budget.
Okay.
So we don't do anything with payroll. That is all done by Debbie. It's all formula-driven. It's all a percentage of increase. So those are all blank. So what I did, and as a trio, we can go ahead and evaluate these numbers, but the contingency, I left it the same, $5,000. The numbers I plugged in actually decreased our spending and gives us a little over 2% left over.
Okay.
So then the second line, office supplies and materials, these are BARS numbers that are required by law. And that's that handout I gave you from the Mathers.
Yeah, the BARS code. That okay, I went through that last night. So okay, so
perfect.
All these numbers are different parts of this account.
Exactly, so every single account is gonna have 110, which is salaries and wages.
Okay.
Every single one is gonna have 210, which is office supplies and materials.
Okay.
And then if you are curious exactly what 210 is, you can look in the bars charts and there'll be a definition.
Okay.
And Debbie, of course, has it all memorized. But this is what we've spent. We budgeted 400, we spent 336. I increased it to 450 based on these previous year's numbers that were a little higher. For operating supplies, 0, 0 for those 2 years, and then 600, 274. So I put 300 in here based on the six, so it's kind of an average.
Isn't there, didn't we just do something with computers? But that's in 2016, not 2017, right?
2017, not 2018.
Okay.
Yeah, and we could actually put it off till next year, I think. You know, for me, I think I can easily go a couple of months.
Okay.
Let's see, repair and maintenance supplies, looking at what our running average is. I put 300, and that was the computer, planning for the computer, and the car. The car gets older, it's gonna need a little bit more. We cover the fleet in here. Postage box, postage for a mass mailing. We had 2,000 last year because we were doing a newsletter when the newspaper was, not. Bobby has turned around the newspaper. We don't see as much of need for.
They're gonna have just a master copy of everybody.
As we did, so I reduced that to 200.
So
mine.
So yours will be in here.
Is this a fraction?
That's what we're showing my right now.
17, not 18, and does that fall in Doug's department?
Correct.
Okay.
Yep. This would be, we had a, with the Misty project, we had a bunch of people come forward and they wanted to do some zoning. We actually assisted that with postage, and that would be where this would come in now, with that newsletter. So the next one is the same thing, it's related to the newsletter. That's where this jumped so high, so I took it back down to 200 for now. Those are probably way low.
Okay.
Also with publications, that's coming up. So with publications, maybe this one, we'll be buying law books, the commission. We don't buy a whole series. We generally buy Title 76 and Title 7.
Okay.
So that number is 200. Publicity and subscriptions, I was planning on those law books and popped it to 9.
Okay.
That's what we budgeted last year. Utility services, I kept it the same. We came in under. Mike's done such a good job with replacing windows and sealing air gaps, and I don't expect this big a jump. We really had a jump in utility rates this year. We don't have another one coming, so this should be pretty accurate. And the year's not over yet. Professional services, we may need to bump this. We'll see. If we need to keep paying for legal services, that's where that would come from, if it's for the commission, or that may be some more money that'll come out of the county attorney's budget.
So that other one, the one that we just had with Corey regarding Deep Creek Legal, that goes to row.
We're going to have to talk about that. It may be one of those where everybody involved pays a percentage.
Okay.
County attorney, commission, DES, road.
Okay.
I don't know yet.
Okay.
We'll have to talk about that. Medical and psychological. We don't use that, so that's where I plugged in the computer and put 1500.
Okay.
My computer was refurbished 9 years ago. I don't have a need for it, but a new computer refurbished is fine. Repair and maintenance services, that again is the car. I put it at 600. We just replaced the tires, the windshield, and the Explorer. I took it down from 1,000, maybe too sharp a cut, but I believe in cutting. Travel, that's been, climbing, but I just left it the same.
Okay.
Training services. 200, I made it 250. We'll be paying for you again to go in December, and might not be a bad idea for all of us to go in December. the Mako training. Contract services, same thing, just kept it the same. And then when I added it all up, I came out with 2% left over. I would like to talk about this a bit later, but I'm gonna shoot for the compensation board, a 2% increase for employees. If we did plug that into this budget, we still come in less than last year, which I think is a good show of leadership for our department heads. We need to do what we're instructing them to do, in my opinion. If we can come in under last year's numbers, it's a lot easier for us to say, we think you should too. So, if those are agreeable to you, we can go ahead and submit those to Debbie. If you wanna reevaluate, that's fine too, I'm happy to.
They'll show us preliminary anyway, so we still get mid-final judgment.
Right, but we have to turn in something preliminary, so.
So if we were to go out and get the time clock that I had been talking about, what department would that fall into?
That would probably be our responsibility, since we're dictating to the departments that they have to do this. I think you'd find a lot of departments saying, I don't have the money. So we'd have to find the money, and then we'd also have the maintenance and the upkeep and the material costs. So we'd have to find money to put in there.
So I'd find the price for those, the system. Black Mountain will match them with. So do I go to Black Mountain and find out what's compatible with their system, or do I have Debbie and Michelle do that to do that research on that?
They have a program,
which is a better plan.
Okay.
That's got time clock module.
Okay.
I asked Lindsay about it, and I have to get a hold of Dave. And then they want to schedule time to come down here and do a presentation.
Okay.
So that's just kind of where we're at with that. It'll be each module we have, there's an additional cost.
Yeah.
So it's just a matter, I think, with everybody with a computer access, logging in their time.
Okay.
And how they do that. Same way with, we're looking at changing the pay period from a semi-monthly to bi-weekly. So it's every other week. They've got a way to account for the third paydays in the month that will help with the deductions that typically right now we do the two a month because it's easier to split.
Yeah.
But they have a way that it separates that so I don't have to mess with that. It would help with the comp time overtime situation and the way the work week's in the middle of a pay period versus end of the week.
Okay.
Might make it easier. So that all into one is what we're looking at. Making changes.
So can we get a figure on that from you?
Working on it. They want to come to a presentation. I just need to schedule with Dave.
Okay.
And have him come down and find a date.
Okay.
And it won't be quite a time clock. It'll be what we do right now, but online.
Yeah.
So
okay. It'll be like a time clock because you'll have your electronic stamp signature when you kind of like, I think like cash register places they when you check out. That's your log in, log out. That's kind of your time clock.
Okay.
So that will be kind of the concept. You have to get on a computer, log in, and that will pretty much start your time.
Okay.
If I understand it right now, when the presentation
we'll
comes.
We'll do the presentation and see where we're at.
Yeah.
Okay. So everything there, I think, everything else there, as far as I can see, looks like it will probably be sufficient for what we do.
Okay. All right.
I'll make a copy to Debbie. So Dana's here, 10:15, for his part of the budget stuff.
Yep, what, Dana? All right, I'm gonna roll this around over here. Mine's pretty cut and dry. I do not have a separate thing for everybody.
That's right.
Do I need that or?
No, we have our own.
Okay.
We just fund 2110. So if you look on this report thing, he's right at the end of the general fund, which is like page 9, I think. It should have the same page as you.
Yeah. Where are you at?
Oh, I just started at the fund, whichever, wherever.
Okay, I got, a lot of my revenue stuff is just pending here, so, right?
Yeah, I've been watching and waiting, and I haven't seen a whole lot come in yet.
The stuff I do have, I know I'm gonna have, I believe, is that little bit of SRS money, is that right?
Mm-hmm.
Twenty-nine something?
Yeah, $44,000, and then we.
Yeah, 29.
I brought the report if you wanted.
Yeah, I've got one here too.
For sequestration, or whatever they called it.
Yeah, it'd be $29,875. And then the school, I believe, was 14 something, but that's a little bit of revenue plus, the gas tax, we're not, I haven't got anything on that yet.
Haven't seen it.
And I'm thinking you're gonna see probably right close to where we've been, maybe a hair higher, possibly. It seems like it goes up just a little bit, you know, a little over $60,000, something like that, for the revenue part of things. I've got, like on some of this revenue, like, be a 34,000. Sales of materials, I sell a little bit of stuff there. I don't make it too high, because I never know what I'm, you know, it's old pipe, or, you know, an old cattle guard, if we have one. You know, just stuff like that, so. I got $500 in materials, and then I got $1,000 in the inspection fees, which usually goes over that. Just kinda depends on how many approaches and encroachment fees, you know, stuff like that, so.
You guys don't have a revenue report, can we get it printed out, sorry, I forgot about that one.
Oh, okay, that's just your national page.
We need that one.
But anyway, that's.
They're so minor at this point, but I can get you a copy when.
No, okay, yeah.
There's just a lot of stuff hinging on that, so.
Yeah, the revenues are hard at this point, cause the year isn't over.
Yeah.
And a lot of the amounts and figures haven't come out.
Okay. Alright, I guess, on the expenditure part of things, here we, well, the revenue stuff here, we got these grants too, so, I'm not exactly sure where all that's gonna end up.
But that's the first account in your guys' report that he's talking about, that's a grant, that HMEP, that's a grant that came about last year. It's just kinda been.
So.
Hasn't really hit hot and heavy yet.
That's just another.
And you just listed the basic dollars.
Yeah, these are just kinda guesses based on what the grant, or what they expect to pay for. And I included salaries at the time, cause I didn't know how much of that the grant was gonna let them charge. So when you look at your report, there really wasn't any actuals in that, and budgeted, so. It's mostly operations, I think the bigger one later on will be the deep creek one, where we have to keep track of wages and.
Yeah, is that what this, on this, expenditure one, that, this health training grant?
No, that and something different that Mike Conkey, that he, there was three of them that came out, and this was one, has to do with hazard mitigation, something training, so if there's a, like when the truck crashed and there was, how you deal with it, so there was a grant to help you with that or something.
Okay.
Something Mike Conkey got, and it's just, I don't see too much of it, so I don't know how active.
Yeah.
Yeah, so that's why that's in there, because contacting local government services, because it was a Department of Transportation grant, it had to go under the road fund.
Okay.
Which number is that?
That's that first account, that 420701.
Oh, okay.
Under road.
Okay, that's what you're talking about, yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. Anyway, down here on my expenditure stuff, start here basically at, you know, salaries and wages, Debbie will take care of all that stuff, I guess, right?
Yep.
The overtime deal, right now, I mean, it's setting, I think I had, $4,300 in there, I just left that at that for overtime, you know, I mean, we never get even close to that, you know, using all that, so. The employee benefits, Debbie, now, is that Is that like the payoff when somebody leaves? Is that what that is?
It was an extra.
That we usually keep in there for.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
So like when your guys is, you're up there at 30 years, Will, and you help offset the retirement.
Yeah. Okay. Well, I'm going to be. You know, I just left that right where it was at, just for the simple fact that. I'm going to be gone next year. I'll be leaving probably in May, right in there. And my payout's going to be, you know, I'll be full up on my vacation time. I don't know how much sick leave we'll have.
You get 25% of whatever's in there.
Yeah, so that should take care
of
that.
And I've got a report I can run at any given date
that
takes your accruals. And throws all in their tax and everything what it would cost.
Yeah, okay. So anyway, that should take care of that. I'll have Debbie run that, and if it doesn't, then we'll probably raise that up a little bit. But I'm thinking it's under that, so pretty close.
Does that have the same thing in my fund?
Yeah.
For the rest of the county?
Yeah, and I did talk to Will a little bit this morning because I don't know what he's thinking. He's right up at. He bought some time back, so he's right up at like 35 years.
This is his last back payment on that, too.
Yeah.
This week, because pay period.
So,
he's got that 5-year buyback.
Yeah. So, he told me that he's probably going to be here for another 3 years.
Got kids in school.
Tell it, he's
he one that wouldn't know what to do if he didn't have work?
Well, no, he's just. He's just okay with it, what I mean? That's fine.
Okay.
He's been a good employee, so. He'll be, another 3 years. He's only 58 right now, so. But anyway, that's what he told me this morning. Because I asked him just so I could, if he was planning on leaving here, if I could.
Those are some of my questions as I'm working on stuff, too.
Get some more in there or something, in case he was going to leave here next year or something. But I just didn't know because I hadn't talked to him about it. So, okay, anyway, the office supplies, I'm going to leave that at 500. Operating supplies, I'm going to leave that at 3,000, right where we've been. Maintenance and repair, I'll leave that at 45. I think I'm right down on about 15,000 still in there.
Nice.
I'm actually above in most everything here. So, 231. I'm still, I looked at that this morning, I kind of keep a running total on it in my computer, I'm still at probably $40,000 right in there. I got plenty left over here, so. Postage, don't do much of that, I left that at 50. Subscriptions, 300. Utilities, I'm wondering, with Northwest going up, or it went up. I don't know what I have there now. It says 82% here, but is that 82% gone?
Yes. The reports I just pulled this morning, you've spent 96%. You have 4% left.
Yeah, and I mean, February, January and February when it was cold.
Mm-hmm.
And burn some propane. And I was actually a little shocked because I never had it that high, just like everybody else in town.
Right.
So with that, I've got that propane tank sitting out back. I mean, the one we used to have in there before when we went to Northwest, and this, I think it's 1,000-gallon propane tank. But it's still sitting out back, and I don't know whether it would be cheaper for me to put that back in and fill it through Rocky Mountain or
like get those summer fields,
Madison River, and just have a keep full situation in the wintertime. I know it's cheaper.
Mm-hmm.
The propane. So I'm wondering what you guys think about that. I think I could probably save a little bit by doing that. It might be a little bit more of a hassle maybe, but.
If you're on a keep full and you get a summer fill with one of those outfits and negotiate some kind of a contract with whichever one you, I mean, get a negotiation or a proposal from any of them and see where we're at. I'm sure it's gonna be less than the MDT's gonna be, or than Northwest Energy's gonna be.
Yeah, that's what I'm thinking.
And I would think if you got that on a summer fill, you're not, are you gonna go through 1,000 gallons in a year? Is it 1,000 gallon tank?
It's a minimum 1,000. It might be a little bigger than that.
I would think that you'd have a significant, if we can negotiate a contract with one of them on a summer fill and a keep fill, and just to do it for a year so we can do it every year, so that we don't get, you know, somebody doesn't lock us in and then all of a sudden the price tanks way down low again, we get stuck with a higher price.
Well, I know. And I've just been kind of, you know, because I'm on AmeriGas, and I'm going to get rid of that too, but, you know, on my own personal house. I mean, they're normally $1 to $3, depending on the winter. You know, 2 years ago, they were $3 higher than anybody else.
Yeah.
But I was kind of stuck, you know. That's who's delivering the fuel for Northwest right now.
Yeah.
Is AmeriGas. They've got the contract for them. You know, they kind of renew their contract every year with somebody. Northwest does, I guess. So, anyway, that was one of my questions. I think we could save a little bit of money if I did that, but I.
Yeah. I think it's a smart move.
Ask for prices again.
Yeah. Okay.
Like Mike said.
All right.
You need a piece of paper?
Yeah, I do. Please. Thank you. Mm-hmm.
So you can leave it, you think, for now? We revisit later?
Yeah, we'll leave that for now. I'll probably just, yeah, I think I'll just leave it. And then see what I can get down here with this other thing in the next few weeks.
I'll make a note, put notes in it.
All right.
So when we look at this again, we'll know what we're doing.
Okay. Okay, professional services, don't use much of that. Medical, what the heck is medical and psychological? Is that the drug testing?
No, that would be the contracted services. That, I'm wondering if was the CDL exam?
Oh, that's what it is. That's what it is. In fact, I should boost that up to about, I'm going to put that at 400 instead of 90. So I got it.
We had to, when we went with Black Mountain, we have to, it pulls them in differently than CSA did,
yeah.
So we had to split them with the object code instead of a box. And our,
yeah, I guess I wasn't sure what that was.
Yeah.
Maintenance and repair, 360, I'm pretty good with 45,000 there. You know, I do a lot of preventive maintenance. You never know when something's going to happen. Truck motor, something like that, when I went to Mark's, you know, this fall.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I saved a lot of money by doing what I did, but it could cost anywhere from, you know, 15 to 25 grand for a motor, so I think I'm okay on most of all my equipment here right now, so. Building and maintenance, I'll just leave that at 500, won't be much there. Got a few things I should fix up there around outside, but.
Okay, yeah, I thought you got 300 here. So it was 500, right?
I changed it to 5.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. For preliminary.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, okay.
Okay, my travel, I'll keep that at 2. I still got, I mean, I'm still okay on that. The training, 2. We got snow rodeos.
2 on that one now instead of 15.
Yeah, I moved that training up to 2.
Okay.
I'm kind of down on that a little bit, but I don't think it'll be quite as much spend out training you know, as I did. You know, we still got our MSHA, you know, which isn't bad. I'm gonna send Tom to a couple grader classes here this spring, just so he's got, you know, a little bit more. You know, he's doing pretty good. He just, every time you go, you know, you learn something, so.
Right.
But I talked to TJ about that a little bit, you know, and I don't think I'll send the other two guys, because they're, I mean, they're pretty seasoned on it, and you're, it's just kind of a, just a refresher, basically, is what it is when you go to them, so. Let's see. What do we got here? Okay, contract, I'm gonna leave that at 5. I'll leave my metal products, which is culvert, stuff like that, I'll leave that at 10. I don't foresee doing a whole bunch with that. Raw materials, that's my gravel, stuff like that. I'm gonna run that up from 140 to 150. Other materials I use, basically, it's either asphalt or mag chloride.
What page are you on now?
I was on the same page.
Yeah, just flip right over, turn around on the back of that page.
Oh, okay. Okay, I see it now.
Okay, so where are you at, Franklin?
I'm on that. Okay, I see the raw materials and other materials.
Okay, yeah, I'm going to leave. Okay, I'm going to boost the raw materials up to 4 at 150.
Okay.
Other materials be 25,000. Like I say, that's my mag chloride, you know, what I use a little bit here and there, and then asphalt, you know, if I gotta buy some asphalt, that's pretty expensive. So
sure you're gonna bump it up then?
No, I'm gonna leave the,
you're gonna leave it there,
the other materials at 25. The rent, never know when I gotta rent, you know, excavator. So, you know, I haven't had to, but I'm gonna have to do something here this year. I got some rip wrapping to do up on Garner Creek a little bit.
And pumps on those bridges, probably. You're probably using some pumps there, aren't you?
I don't think so.
Should be figured in on the other anyway, on the grant part.
Yeah, it'll be mostly grant stuff. So, okay, the machinery and equipment, the 940. I need a truck. I need a dump truck. So I'm going to end up getting rid of that 88 Ford. And I don't know, I'll probably try to sell it on surplus. Heater doesn't work real good in the wintertime. I mean, I've had it in trying to get things figured out on that, new thermostats. You know, it's just not real good in the wintertime when we're stockpiling, stuff like that. Air conditioner falls apart on it all the time. The condenser falls off for some odd reason. It's just too much rattling. So I'm gonna try to find a dump truck that is already built. I've been looking around. I think I'm gonna have to go upstate, Idaho, Washington, something like that. I've got that up to $75,000. I'm probably not gonna need that. I'd like to stay under 50, but it kind of just depends on what the application is, you know, what you find. So what I've been looking at is, you know, somewhere between a 90, 98, 99 up to about a 2005, something like that, you know, with the, you know, with the drop axle and a 16, 17 foot box.
Be like a 14 yard then, 12, 14?
Yeah, 12 to 14, right in there. Yeah, plus you gotta have a, you know, something that's gonna last you a while, so you ain't work on it all the time. So anyway, that's kind of what I'm looking at as far as dump truck wise.
Roughly 75,000.
Yeah, I've got 75 there. So
you get, does that figure any all of that trade in or where I can sell that? How much do you think you get out of that one there? Much?
I'm gonna bet I could probably get between 10 and maybe 15, I think. Because it's really not a bad dump truck. It just, the heater situation and the air conditioning situation, I mean, you know, when you're out driving in the dust and crap, you know, I mean, it's, you gotta have your windows up and when you pull into a pit or whatever, so. That's what I'm thinking. And I'm thinking if I, you know, the way they're talking at Mackers, you know, on the public surplus thing, you know, I mean, it works pretty good if you can get, once you get people bidding on it. It's just a little bit to get people bidding on it, but if it looks good and at least it's good mechanical shape, you know, drivable and stuff like that, you know, you can do pretty good. It's kind of like that water truck we sold, you know, I got more out of that water truck than I was even expecting to get off that. So, and they pay all the fees. I mean, they don't even charge you to put it on there, you know, it's just, they bid on it, and then, of course, then if they don't come pick it up, then it's still yours, so, even after they pay you. So, anyway, I'm thinking I can get that out of that. And then, like I say, the rest of this stuff, the bridge stuff, I've actually got last, well, however many years here, I've been requesting money out of PILT to help pay for some bridge stuff, some to throw into my 940 fund, and last year I think I put in for some gravel here too, but I've been requesting $75,000 to go into my CIP. I'm going to leave that out. I mean, I don't think I'm going to need it with the little bit of cash I'm going to have left. I think I can, you know, the way we're rolling things over, I think we can. I think maybe next year they may have to upgrade a grader or something. You know, maybe. But I think with what I've got, I think I can do that. Just by that. So I'd like to request 10 for to go into my bridge fund. I boosted that up from 5 to 10. And then if I could have another 50,000, request another 50,000 out of PILT to go into my 450 into my raw materials. So I could have a little bit extra, you know, I mean, just because every once in a while I'll go buy some up here at Capital Concrete if I've got a road close, you know, because we ran out of the stuff at Amwell. So, you know, Winston, or we did a bunch on Desert Drive last year. We hauled a bunch in on that because that road was kind of a snowy pot. So
now, and you probably have to go there to get the gravel for
it is, and it's right. I mean, that's all in the grant process.
Yeah, right.
This here is completely separate than that. It's just a request, you know, if you don't do it, you don't do it, that's whatever, you know, I mean, we can still probably get by fine. It's just a little extra help is all it is. And other than that, my gas tax, basically, you know, I'm just gonna, I think I got for my revenue part. Well, my gas tax, I left a repair and maintenance situation at $45,000 from the 2820 on my expenditure.
He's looking at the gas tax, which is 2820.
Yeah. That's going to be on page about 27. Because
it's a different account, 2820.
Yeah.
For fund. Sorry.
You're leaving that the same, Dana?
I am. I'm going to leave that the same. And like I say, once we get the actual figures, then I'll figure out how much I've got left on each one, which I don't know a lot.
Okay.
You know, so we'll be fairly close to the same. I'm thinking we might be able to boost up these, you know, the raw materials one and the fabricated and the other materials up a little bit, possibly. I kind of even those out from where we were last year. So we'll be close to the same.
Okay.
And this gas tax on the expenditure part of things there on that 230, I usually try to use most of that for gas, diesel tires at first, you know, and then leave my 2110 alone so I, you know, can just make sure I have plenty left in that.
Can we use the
You're gonna leave there with those expenses all the same, under 2020?
Well, what I wanna do is I wanna put, I moved them a little bit, Debbie, I moved the raw materials from five, well, I left that at five. The fabricated materials, I went from 8 to 5. And then on the other materials, you know, which would be your mag chloride or something if you need it, I went from 2,000 to 5,000, so. I kinda just even those two out. You know, fabricated materials, I think were, I'm not sure what that was, maybe chloride, asphalt maybe.
Well, that'd be a bridge, like those bridge decks, that you have, I don't know if you have to put any in or not, would that be fabricated?
Yeah, probably. I think so, it'd be concrete.
Yeah.
Yeah.
The prefab decks. So if you know what page you're gonna get now, I'll go, I have to, I keep track of these pages.
It flipped over to page 28. It flipped over to page 28, so it started on the bottom and flipped over. And they're back to back.
Okay, here's 28. Okay.
He did 5,000 for each 450, 470, and 490 objects.
Yeah.
Where I had 8,000, you know, on the 470, I just evened that one and the 490 out. 470 and 490. And I think, other than the other revenue and stuff like that that'll be coming later, I'm thinking that's about all I got. I got what I did too, and I'll give you guys each one of these.
Thank you.
I actually am requesting a market adjustment for myself for 55 cents an hour. Like I said, once again, if you feel that's feasible, that's fine. If it's not, that's fine too. I'm not gonna sit here and complain and whine, and this will be the last time I bring it up, so.
Thank you for this. Hey, Dana, two questions. Debbie, can you explain to Mike how the road department works, since it's unique? And one question for you, Dana. If the county compensation board were to come back with a 2% increase for staff, can you afford that in your budget without taking away from operations?
Yeah.
Okay. I thought so based on your numbers, but I wanted to just put it out to you.
Yeah. So, I don't know if you guys got any questions for me. I think that's about all I have. Where's my budget still?
And Mike, if you, the CIP for road is 4,005. So if you want to see what he's at on that. Or, but Debbie, would you explain how that works? Since it's, we don't really have very much control over this particular fund.
He's a standalone. He has his own mills and valuations that we do separate. So he, well, it's county roads, miles, and Department of Revenue adjusts it, and he's got his own evaluations, separate, kind of like the hospital, soil conservation, rural fire, Three Forks mosquito. They're their own separate, and they have their own evaluation based on what's encompassed in theirs. So his, what he does really doesn't affect anything that the rest of us do, because it doesn't come out like the floating mill for the general fund.
Okay.
And we don't assign any to him, so it's basically on his own, and whatever PILT monies to help offset some of those needs, since it's in lieu of tax money anyway. It kind of offsets what taxes doesn't collect.
And either one of them on that PILT, I mean, if that's, it would be, it's always nice to have a little extra there. If you drop one or the other, I would rather have something go into the bridge part of it.
Yeah. I think you're.
Well, that's something I think we were told we needed to start doing because we didn't have much in it for a while.
Yeah, we didn't have nothing.
Yeah, so we were told it was a good idea because some of that infrastructure part is.
Well, I know how everything is. I know that.
How's 50,000, how many yards are you gonna get crushed for that?
You get close to 10. You know, if I had 66,000 there, I'd get 10,000 there. But that's good. I'm okay with that. Cause I got that, I got it on my 2110 too, some money in there for that too, so.
Like Debbie said, maybe increase on, well, we've got time on that, but that'd be something to think about, maybe increasing that bridge part.
Yeah, and that's up to you guys. I'm not gonna, like I said, I'm not gonna sit here and whine and complain about my budget. I do pretty well, I think, and got pretty much what I need. I just, you know, the dump truck, I need to do that. And like I said, the 75,000 there, I'm probably not gonna spend 75, but I think if I'm gonna get something, you know, it's decent, you know, it's gonna last for a while, I'm gonna have to get up into the 50 to 60 range.
Oh yeah, I'm sure.
You know, I mean, there's a lot of dump trucks out there that are just, I could actually build one too, but it's gonna cost me the same amount of money to build one. By the time I get a tractor and then I gotta, you know, put the dump switches on it, and I gotta put the, you know, the box on. And in fact, I saw a box the other day on one of the truck papers there. It was, you know, brand new box for $20,000. And that's just for the box, that's not putting it on. So, anyway.
That's 88 Ford, right, that you're gonna get rid of?
Yeah.
I had it written down, so I'm writing it down again here.
And then, you know, that would just go back into, you know, into my CIP.
Yeah.
For something down the road, you know, or just save it for next year or something, so.
Looks like a good plan.
I appreciate you having these meetings. I mean, you know, it's kind of nice, you know, because I mean, I've never done this before. I normally just fill out my stuff, give it to Debbie, and, you know, then we kind of just go through it for the next few months, you know. But, you know, this is good.
Glad to hear that. Thank you.
So you take that money that you get from that, from the 88, and just put that basically into your capital improvement.
Yep.
Portion of the budget.
Yeah, whatever it might be. And I, like I said, I feel pretty confident somewhere between 10,000 and 15,000. You know, it's.
Are you using any now, or you're not using it now, are you?
Using what?
The 88.
Oh yeah, we use it here and there. Yeah.
Oh yeah.
When I got everybody hauling, yeah, we. We've been using it up until just last week before. So.
Maybe as long as you get rid of it, so something doesn't happen.
No, I won't get rid of it.
You think it'll be all right?
Yeah, until we get. Yeah, and it runs fine. I mean, it really does.
It's just those little things.
Yeah, just some little things, you know, and stuff rattling apart, and it's loud inside, you know, and I mean, it's just the way it is. Some construction company guy or something like that, I'd be happy to have it.
Yeah.
In fact, the city's actually asked me a couple times if I wanted to sell it, but I don't think the city will buy it. They've already said they won't use the one they got, but they use it all the time. So. Check on that propane deal. Try in the next couple weeks to get something figured out if it's gonna, you know, kind of where I'll be for a year or something.
Okay.
Yeah.
I don't know. Like I said, I was a little bit flabbergasted over them couple bills I got here in January and February. I never had a bill there like that. I mean, it was, I think that one was $1,300.
Yeah.
Yeah. Never had a bill like that.
Pricey.
Okay, well. Just go in, I'll go do something.
Thanks.
Yep.
Thanks, Dan.
Thanks, Dan.
Yep, and just let Michelle know if you need a copy of Brady.
Yeah, I think I got her now.
Okay.
Thanks.
Scott Gunning, weed coordinator.
I gave you the packages right before the meeting, my stuff, just so we don't have to go through the major packages and try to get everything, but pretty much everything's set for me, especially in the weed department. I've been allotted 6.6 mils since 2006, and that was voted on by the taxpayers of Bradwater County, so any adjustments in there, I, you know, basically keep it within that allotted mill value. The only thing that really changes from year to year is under my contracted services, which is where I put my MDT, BLM monies, and so that goes up and down from year to year. And then occasionally, if I have a little leftover, if I think there's a special needs area, I can go ahead and draw some of my funds and put it into there as well. But pretty much everything as far as revenues and expenditures, I keep in that 6.6 mils. And then if I do have carryover, I have been carrying that into a CIP and a cash fund for, you know, unexpected expenditures, I guess you could say. So I don't think there's any major changes under that one that we've noticed. The only thing is I'm going to have to go through some of my equipment this year and probably do some routine maintenance as general, maybe some upgrades. The Forest Service, BLM, even the state lines are starting to rely on county weed districts a lot more to help them out and to hold spray days. And so I may be looking at, you know, purchasing some equipment this spring, like a six-wheeler and a trailer. If that's the case, I'm working with the weed board on how they want to do that, if they want to dump a bunch of money into the equipment that we do have, or if they want to go ahead and upgrade and get some new equipment. we'll be coming back, but that'll be coming out of the CIP funds for the cash reserves that I've been putting away for years. Any questions as far as that goes, expenditures?
And Mike, for you, being new, because the citizens voted for 5 mils for weed, that money stays with weed. We can't pilfer it out. And then statute, I don't remember, maybe you know which one, says that you have to do at least 1.6 mils or $100,000 for weed, whichever's less. So we go to 1.6. So that's where the 6.6 comes from.
It's his 2140 fund. The account number. Or fund number. 2140.
What was the number again?
2140.
2140.
What page? That's going to be on page 10.
Oh, that's in this other.
That's in the big one. He gave you a separate breakdown for his own, but in the big packet, it's in page 10.
But I mean, so far, even with some of the unexpected expenditures that I had this last year, like the six-wheeler, you know, having the sticker, the T-poster, whatever it was, tear all that stuff out, you'll see that, you know, I'm still coming in under my expenditures pretty greatly. And, you know, I try to always, one thing that I have done in the past and I always try to do is I always try to make the budget where I can give back to the taxpayers, whether that's through holding spray days or donations to, like, this coming up this weekend is the Ag Appreciation Dinner. I always give donations towards that kind of stuff, of herbicide, things like that. And so I always try to, you know, over budget so that I can give back, I guess, in certain areas, I guess, is the best way to do it. So, yeah. And still stay within the 6.6 mil. Just trying to think of how to say that.
I
2840, grants, that's where I put a lot of my, like if I have chemical sales, unexpected chemical sales, my weed inspection fees for your subdivisions, things like that. I do get, some of them revenues out of there. And I also get, a special county reservation grants and an MDT grant. I don't ever want to put them in my 2140 because they're not guaranteed monies. So I try to budget them under my 2840s. That way, if they fluctuate, you know, I still have kind of a set idea and I'm not relying on them funds to do my general operations. So most of my expenses come out of that 6.6 mils, with the exception if I do get them other funds or them other revenues, then once in a while I'll check and see how my 6.6 mil or my 2140 budget is, and I can fluctuate my, by need by adding my 2840. And then my 2840, I also have special grants that I work with. Like right now, I'm kind of waiting on hearing from a RAT grant that I put in for the, I guess, kind of the northwest side of the county. If I get that, that'll be approximately $25,000 there. And then Forest Service has some potential for grant funds coming in that they'll be utilizing the weed department as well. So. Any questions on those? Comments, thoughts?
How much do you say that grant might be if you get for the northwest part of the county?
For the RAC grant would be about $25,000 is what I applied for. And that'll be a combination of herbicide and spray days or contracted services. I still have a little bit of grant funds for the Deep Creek area. They're about, what, I think $3,000, I think it's right around, a little over $3,000 of the Deep Creek grant that I've got to utilize this summer. So, yeah.
Weren't they going to pass a bill in the legislature for a weed fee on vehicles or something? Did that get killed or did that go through?
That got killed. And I just found that out yesterday. With that extra fee for that vehicle. So basically, that's what that funding was going to go for was the under my grant, it's 334025, the weed program. 80-7-814. That's that special county reservation grant and the MDT grant that I was talking about. That, you know, I kind of, you budget it every year off of what you have. There's $7,500 was coming from the license plate fees to help us with our roads and stuff. That legislation that they were trying to approve, that fee has not increased or has not changed since like 1986, I want to say. Doesn't mean that our roads aren't being used heavier by recreationists and other people. And so they were going to try to get that up there. And what that would have brought that up was from the 7,500 up to around 15,000 to 20,000 to help us count it out. But it didn't pass, so we're told to keep it at the 7,500. And that's where that 9, I think on that page 3 or 4 on the B250, that $9,286 comes from. That 7,500, one thing about it is it is specially earmarked funds. You cannot use it for commercial applicator or for purchasing herbicides.
Oh, okay.
It is for pretty much anything and everything except for them two things. Any questions, comments on the weed stuff?
Not for me.
Go to the mosquito then? The mosquito, based it off of the mosquito district's mill levy, and I'm just requesting, gonna request the same as always at 10.27 mils, which I think in the past, is that the 30,000 or whatever that it is? I think that, we've just based it off of the mill values that you've been saying before. The contracted services were right in the middle of negotiating with FWPBOR, but they told us just to go off of the 8,000 that they've used in the past, but they're gonna try to work some funding in there, because they're starting to realize too that there's more costs than what meets the eye.
Adam's requesting 18. Adam Grove with FWP.
Yeah, but he didn't know for sure, so. For all intents and purposes at this time, I'm just gonna go off the 8,000 as recommended and what's been used in the past. And we're gonna kinda work on that as well. Maybe do a little bit of changing, because there's been a lot of questions on whether we can, how much we can do in-house versus all contracted out. Doing some, looking at some contract negotiations with JHS. Just because we think we can save the people money by doing some of the larval stuff in-house, you know, the surveys and some of the major surveys in-house versus contracting that out. So the
mosquito's the same, because it's a district, the money is dedicated to mosquito, can't be used for anything else.
And it's not pulled from the general fund.
And are you still, there's talk of expanding that district, is that gonna happen, or do we know?
There's talk of it, I haven't gone for sure. I'm looking into it, and I just started finding some stuff. That would have to be brought about by the taxpayers within that, or that district would affect. And I think that would be the proper route, is going through the mosquito board, having the people come to the mosquito board, asking if we would back it, and then if so, getting a petition signed by the people that it would affect, and then coming before the commission to ask for a change in their, you know. But I don't know exactly, that's just kind of a quick one. It's not a huge or a major district, but again, on the west side, there's some areas up along the northwest corner down to about the city limits that people say and that they're getting affected by the pond over on that side pretty heavily. And they're talking about, yeah, we would like to, you know, have a fogger come through and have, you know, because that pond fluctuates so much.
Yeah.
That, you know, whether the larva sighting takes exactly or not. So. Any more questions?
Yes, I have one. Scott, I'm going to be asking the County Compensation Board. CPI is 1.3%, just basic management. That's a place to start, it's not a place to end. So I'm going to ask for consideration of 2% COLA for employees. Would that affect your budget or your ability to perform your duties in your budget?
No.
I don't think so.
I think if you look, we've budgeted and I did budget, because that's the one change in the mosquito budget that hadn't been there for a couple of years. As part of the negotiations of me taking over, you know, I've got some compensation for that. I've also got some employee compensation for that. we're going on the high end when we do the salaries and wages portion and all that stuff, we go on the high end. That way, if there's any fluctuation, but also, if you look, some of that can be absorbed because we have a pretty strong CIP budgets and cash on hand budgets between the mosquito and the weed.
Yeah, you have a nice CIP for both.
And if you look at, I included that on the end. If we do major equipment upgrades or purchase equipments, if you look on the very back of that package, that's where we sit. And I think you'll see that we've got a very strong budget. Both mosquito and weed have been saving for quite a few years. You know, we're the one that, one department that has never came and asked for PILT funds to go and purchase our own equipment. We do it straight out. You know, and if we don't have the cash or the money backing us, we don't do that. We don't come to you. We've been lucky so far and been able to work it very diligently. That's the one thing about me is I run a very fiscally conservative budget. So I try to make sure that I have a little left over every year in case there is an emergency or in case we do have equipment breakdowns unexpectedly and stuff like that. And so.
Thanks, Scott. You've answered all my questions.
Any questions from either one of you folks?
No questions.
No.
Well, thank you. As Dana said, I think this is great to be able to sit down and talk about all this stuff, and I think it's good that we get it accomplished, before we get crammed in and everybody's busy. So, thank you folks for your time.
Thanks.
My door is open if you have any questions.
Missy Kosh.
The hospital district?
Hospital district, yeah.
Good morning, all. You're almost back on schedule, aren't you?
Yeah, closer.
I don't know if Missy Cox prepared this budget, and she's been on the clerk for a number of years. And did she give you copies here? I got them for you. Here, why don't I move over here and Vic, why don't you grab me? Oh, you got a chair up there. All right. It's all on reading on page 2. Essentially, we're asking the same thing we got last year. It was 2.34 mils, which then yielded about $30,000. Our big expense or for tax-wise is that voter-approved mill levy, which yields $170,000 a year. And that is always traditionally, when I was on the hospital board, the THS board, about 10 years ago I got on there, and at that time we had a voted mill levy of $150,000 for 3 years. And I think we did that, and we got that renewed for 3 more years, and then about 3 years ago we got a $170,000 mill levy. And that's always been used, I think, traditionally for anything that the hospital really needed. Often it was for maintenance, new roofing or carpets or rooms or boilers or stuff like that. This $170,000 now is going for a loan payment. And seems like a bottomless pit to you, doesn't it, Frank?
I see here you got an Intercap loan payment.
Yeah, that Intercap loan is, that's through the State Board of Investments, it's about 1.5%, which is a great loan. And we had to take that out. We did that when I was on the, I don't know if I was on, still on the board when we did that or not. The hospital got behind on, they were overpaid by Medicare for a number of years. Overpaid a lot. Got up to where it was around $400,000 or more in overpayments. And finally, when Medicare decided they want the payment back, they had to get, we got to get it, or we would pay terrible penalties. So that's what the mill levy is going to pay now. We've got to pay two more payments, three more payments, one in September, then in February, and then one next year, and then it'll be all paid off. I think, frankly, the hospital was probably damn lucky at that time that it was getting overpaid by Medicare, because we were really in tough shape. When I got on the board, things were going downhill fast, and I think I was on for about 2 years, and we got to the point, we bounced the payroll. Couldn't make it. And we went to the banks, we talked to everybody, and no help. And so I was advocating, I quietly said to the board members, I think we got to fold this up and close the hospital. Well, thank God the community really rallied, and they didn't put up with that for a minute. And Bill Kern's bank gave us $100,000. And met the bounce payroll. He was a hero, and the bank was a hero. And anyway, we've been doing one for, we're finally, the hospital, I think, CHS board has done a remarkable turnaround. Things are better, a lot better. And once we get that, we're gonna have to ask for another mill levy when this voted levy is expired. We'll have to ask for another one. I know we will. Traditionally, at least when Dr. Swenson was the chairman of the hospital district board, and in my early years, mostly we were using it, as I recall, for maintenance of the buildings. Those buildings belong to the county, and we don't want them to go run down. So that's mainly what we use for. I would like someday to get back to that, if we could, as much as possible. But there have been other times when we needed to ask the hospital district for emergency money, and they came through. They always held back a cushion, and we had to ask for it when I was on the THS board. I've only been on this hospital district board for about 6 months, last July, I think I got appointed. Vic Sample has been on since just January. I was appointed to replace Barbara Kircher when she died. And so I'm filling her unexpired term. Then Janet Hubber resigned in January, and the board appointed Vic to replace her. So that's where we stand right now. Any questions? Missy's here that could answer any questions, or Jenny Klaus from the CFO at the hospital. If anybody's got any questions or whatever.
Yeah, maybe you can clear us up. I understood this Medicare overpayment come from when the nursing home was closed, they continued sending claims in, and then Medicare said you have to pay this back.
Jenny can explain that more than I can.
No, so what happens is the Critical Access Hospital is a reimbursed-based. Medicare reimburses us based on how many patients are in the hospital. It has nothing to do with the nursing home. It's the Critical Access Hospital. So what happened was, it's almost like a tax return, and they based it on the prior year. So the year we closed, we only had maybe 10 patients in the hospital, and they take the whole cost of the hospital. So let's say it costs $1 million to run the hospital, and you only have one patient in there. Medicare is going to reimburse you the $1 million cost for one patient. And then the next year, let's say you have 10 patients, well, it still only costs you about $1 million to run the hospital, because you have to have the same 24-hour care to have a hospital. So if you have 10 patients and it's $1 million, they pay you each day the patient's in there, they break it up. So they're going to pay us $1 million times 10 for for every patient, because they think it costs $1 million for one patient, because that's what it cost last year, which is not the case. So when you do your tax return's a cost report, it's called, they go back and calculate and go, oh, really, it wasn't, it should only have been $100,000 a patient. So you guys need to pay us back that $9 million. So that's what it was. It has nothing to do with the nursing home. It has nothing to do with the necessarily the closure or any claims being sent in, because that's not really how it works. Even though you call Medicare and you say, you guys, you know you're overpaying us, they go, oh, well, yeah, we'll get to it at the end when you do your cost report. And we'll calculate it out then, because we don't really believe you know what you're talking about. In the meantime, we were struggling. We needed the cash, period. So they actually paid us $1.2 million too much. We were able to save most of that and pay it back, and we still needed the loan to finish the remainder, which is a little over $400,000. So the fact that the hospital was able to not spend all the $1.2 million and pay back the majority of it was a pretty big deal. And then we're certainly grateful that that mill levy was there and available to us. And so what's happened is the hospital has started maintaining the building themselves. So $35,000 for the roof last year because we didn't get mill levy money because it had to go back to pay down money. So it's all working out. But
it's been real touch and go. I think, thank God Medicare was overpaying actually, because we needed that to finance our operations at that time. I'm glad the hospital managed to save a lot of it, but anyway. You know, I've learned that I think all rural hospitals in Montana and probably throughout the nation are really, really in tight financial straits, and it's not going to change, not at all. And we're not alone. The big hospitals are having the same problems we are, and they all have their fundraisers, and they all have their foundations to support them. It's, medical care is tough. It is. I think it's going to get tougher.
Go ahead.
I'm not saying anything. All I can say about is Medicare is infinitely complicated. We are in healthcare. We deal with healthcare and reimbursements, and we take care of a lot of Medicare patients. We have taken care of siblings in our office on the same day that we're treated minutes apart, and those payments come back with two different reimbursements. We have come back with husband and wife couples that have come back from Medicare with two different reimbursements. Our fees are 10% of what the hospitals are, just due to the complexity of our of the care. But it's not as you work with a third party in North Dakota. The third party in North Dakota works on behalf of Medicare. So there's a lot more people, and it's a lot more complicated, and it's way more unpredictable than it seems like it should be. I don't understand it. We just write off the difference and move on to something else. And like I said, I'm just saying that's how we handle Noridian. Medicare's second intermediary.
Can't argue with
so when does the mill levy run out?
I think, I'm not sure.
It runs out May of 2019.
Okay.
So we will be coming in for with a, asking for a resolution to put one put a new mill levy on the ballot. I don't know what's going to what the board's going to. Our board right now is pretty weak. With us, Vic and I being so brand new, and Bob Davis, who's our chairman, apparently does not want to be chairman anymore, and he hadn't. I think he missed the last two meetings. He hadn't been very active, so we're gonna. It's gonna be tough. We gotta change things around here.
You and I will have to come up to speed quicker.
Yeah.
How many board members do you have?
Five.
And you only have
Darlene Doig and John Ingalls.
So you have
Bob Davis.
Four that are active, right?
Yeah.
Bob,
that's right. Yeah. I think Bob Davis and Darlene have been on for a number of years. John Ingalls has been on for about three, I think.
So if you run this this approved mill levy, you're gonna have, this loan will essentially be paid off by time this, by the time this vote approved mill levy expires. So what will you spend that, if you get that 170, will that go back into building maintenance?
I don't know how that coincides when they run out. We have a payment to make in September, and then next February, and then next, the following September, so.
So you've got three payments?
We've got three more payments.
Okay.
Two more.
I think we have four payments, you.
Oh, do we? I thought we had three.
The intention was that mill levy was collateralized almost exactly for those 3 years to that loan, at 1.5%.
But to answer your question, at the point where we quit paying the mills, then we need to start building up the fund to, you know, do the building maintenance, so that we have the money to pay for the repairs when they come up.
I see on my tax bill too, there's something called the ambulance. But I understand that's a fund that is accumulated to buy ambulances as we need them or replace them, is that right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
It is, yeah. Every 10 years, it's set up to replace.
That doesn't go to the hospital district at all, so it totally separate.
Yeah. Just know, saved in their CIP for the ambulance.
Okay.
How large is the payment left on that comes due in October? I don't see it on here.
Well, in August.
Is it August?
Yeah, I've got, principal payment is $94,816 I got.
It doesn't say yet.
Oh, it doesn't, yeah, because what happens is they reevaluate every February their interest rate. And so they wait and send you out a new one every February of what your predicted amount.
So we don't know the interest yet.
So it's roughly 94,000, is that right?
Right, 95. 94,800.
I base those on the ones that we just paid.
94,800 is the principal payment due in August. This August.
I was thinking it was October.
Then the following February, 95.38 plus interest. The difference is because there are different number of days in that.
That's a different loan too, isn't it?
No, same loan. There's only one loan there.
But they reevaluate it every year, right?
Yeah.
They revolve
their
interest.
And they're slated to increase interest to 2% this year.
And on the budget, we do have expenses. And there's always emergencies, there's always been emergencies. Anyway, the $30,000 or whatever we can get from the unvoted mill levy, which was last year 2.34, it won't go wasted for sure.
Is that different from the $400,000 loan from the county?
That's a different loan, yes.
So that's what comes due in October.
Oh, I see why you thought it was in October. I don't know much about that one.
That's with the hospital.
Ends in October this year.
Correct.
Yes.
That's the one the county made the two payments on.
Yeah. So we're getting that debt retired, thank God.
So that's on top of this over here?
That is. That doesn't go to the hospital district.
So it's not on top of it, Frank?
No.
It's separate.
That loan has nothing to do with the district. That's simply for the THS.
Right, yeah. But it's still...
Yeah, it's still a liability. Mm-hmm. Yeah. But the hospital is managing that and paying it off. And thank God the bank was willing to loan loan it through the county, because the hospital had, THS has no collateral, and no credit rating. I think the bank examiners would have come down hard.
See, that's when Corey's been on.
Yeah.
That has to be taken care of.
Yeah. And as I understand it, they want to take out a loan to pay that off, pay the county's debt off. So that'd be retired. I think their finances are coming around.
But you know how much that one is.
Jenny knows, I don't.
How much is that one that's due then in October?
$128,000.
$128,000, that sounds about right.
And then it's paid off. So what we're actually trying to do right now is refinance it and get it in the hospital's name and out of the county's name. But in order to do that, the only way we can do it is probably to put a mortgage on one of the buildings that the hospital district owns, which would be the ambulance or the hospital. So again, it's gonna end up going through the hospital district, because THS doesn't own anything.
So that one went right direct to THS then?
Pardon?
That $400,000 one went directly to THS.
That's behind the proceeds from it, yeah, it went through the county.
Any other questions?
Nope, you answered all mine, thanks.
Thank you. Thank you for your consideration.
Thank you.
Because they were emailed to me, right. And I wasn't sure how I was supposed to responsibly deal with them. My name is Adam Six. I'm here on behalf of BCDC, the Broadwater County Development Corporation, officially. Unofficially,
what's your name?
Adam Six, just like the number, S-I-X, with BCDC, officially. Unofficially, I'm on the board of directors for the Townsend Area Chamber of Commerce, and I'm also the vice president of the Townsend Area Food Pantry for the last 5 years. So thank you for your support of the food pantry in the past. I've always wanted to come to one of these meetings, but I never have. We try and be responsible with everything, and we appreciate it. So thank you for that. Here are your handouts for today. BCDC is the Broadwater County Development Corporation. We've been generously receiving help from the county since 1993, I understand. And most of this money goes back to the county. Really, all this money, depending on how you break it out, goes back to the county, back to groups. We purchased a $35,000 or $40,000 cedar that's used quite a bit. And that had some other grants to do with it. A lot of the storefront grants in town, recent businesses, have been, that has utilized. The most recent ones that come to mind for me are the Creamery. Wanda had a small improvement to her building. Full Belly Deli. And the Lumberyard all have had improvements that we've sponsored, that we've supported in the last year. In addition, Casey Tire. We put a handrail on the professional building are the things that really come into mind. In this list, you'll see quite a few other things. We're an active supporter of the Slice this summer. We help with Shakespeare in the Park, the Bike Fund, All sorts of stuff we do. There has been a storefront grant, approved so far. In the past, we have managed and moderated the flowers in town, the flag posts in town, decoration for Christmas. The group really does a good job to move forward and make things attractive and progressive. You know, it's not shellac on old statues. It's life, it's vitality, it's things looking good and presenting themselves well. Most recently, the project that I've been most involved in has been the internet development, fiber development locally. We're moving to a world where information technology is probably as important as water and sewer. If you don't have the supporting stuff, if you don't have the internet access, you can't do what you needed to do. It used to be that a person would have to go around to floppy disks with computers and they'd have to update all these computers. Do you have the updates? Do you have the updates? Now, all this software is remote and it's just updated like that. So it's not as critical that you have this update because it's done for you. It's outsourced, it's delegated. Through our office, we work with people, our insurance claims are handled. They used to be handled in Helena, now they go to California. And that's just the way things are moving. Electronic payments, all that stuff, it's all cloud-based. Different employees in the area. This is a great area where people can base here and work elsewhere. They can have lower overhead and work elsewhere, function elsewhere. That's able to be performed. How important is internet here? Internet here for the students in this school is 20 times slower than it is in White Sulphur Springs. Those are national numbers accepted by the Department of Education. Those aren't some goofy numbers. That's the most important thing that this group is working on, I feel, right now. And quite a few hours have been devoted to meetings recently about that. This group purchased the silos area, wetlands area, which can in the future be repurposed for camping, for a wide spot in the road to pull over and have a picnic, for a lot of different things. So that's exciting. This group does a lot of great projects. You know, they're not a talking about talking group. And I think that's critical because how many hours of your life do you want to spend in doing stuff like that? So you're welcome to skim through this later. BCDC maintains a webcam that gets a ridiculous amount of traffic because people want to see what the weather's like. Some of them even want to watch their kids walk to school because they know that their kids should be coming down the street at whatever time. The townsandmt.com website hosts a ton of information, contact lists, phone numbers for Broad River County. All the boards, all the city boards, all the county boards, all that stuff is on there. That's a tremendous resource database if you want to figure out who's on the hospital board, who's on the Townsend Health Systems board, who's on this board, who's on that board, who's in charge of weeds in this area, the TV board. I don't even know what the TV board does. I don't even know if TV still stands for television or if that's evolved into something else. So it's 100% volunteer group. No one's paid. The silos was a huge project. The bike path has been tremendous. Hopefully we can update things. We helped improve the gazebo, a lot of the Heritage Park improvements, a lot of different things. It's an entity that doesn't change. And I think that's terrific. As far as our business goes, has BCDC helped our business? Yes. When we first came to town, when we were renting from an individual that replaced a window. BCDC paid for an awning and a half of a window, reimbursed him 50% so he could make those improvements to the building that were, I think he got a check back for $350. How critical is the economic development to our area? This past year, we're working with MBAC. We weren't in a situation being 30-something professionals with debt-to-income ratios that were, like, inverted.